Women have been fighting for many reasons. And just within the past 25 years alone, various movements have been started and organized to bring attention to painful and life-altering situations. Events that we as people would have never thought to see actually became a reality. Women have opened up the door to provide more opportunities for themselves. And even then, it's still not enough doors being kept open. We are entering a new era where women will get the true equality we deserve and are taking major strides in seizing their moments. We're entering the fight the force era, where we as women need to enjoy the fruits of our labors even more. As we celebrate those victories, let us not forget that the next generations need us more than ever, because it's clear that they need guidance. Through this film, the bridge will be gapped. The understanding will be clear. This fight will be one for the ages.
Is it hard being a leader? Because you are in the forefront, huh?
Yeah. I don't know what kind of leader I am, but I don't know. I'm not trying to be a leader. I'm just trying to be me. And if something that I say helps someone else out, Then that's fine. But to go out and say, okay, I'm the role model around these here parts, and I'm the spokesperson for all women, I'm not trying to do that, because we are individuals and we all have minds of our own and things we want to say for ourselves. And I just say the things I want to say is what I say, not what other people want me to say.
Fight the Force, to me, I read the title, it really spoke out to me because women are becoming so much more powerful and just confident in what they're doing and just working hard and just manifesting everything that they want in life.
Fight the Force means stand up for yourself, be bold, be brave, be confident, be out there with who you are, say what you think, speak your mind, take those risks and take those leaps, jump over those boundaries, because until we do that, ladies, we will always be where we are, you know? People that don't take risks never really achieve anything. They just stay stagnant.
The first thing that erected in me that made me say yes before I even went to go and do my research on Fight the Force was, ooh, it's Public Enemy, Fight the Power. And that's a big part of my generation, you know what I mean? And Fight the Power don't mean fight the oppressor. Fight the Power is fight for your power to stand your grounds and be who you are. And so as a woman, Fight the Force is fight that power, fight that force that's pushing you back, that's telling you you can't be this, that's telling you this is who you are. Fight those things that are setbacks.
Every single one of us are battling our own thing, you know, and don't think that for one second I don't have issues or the person next to you has issues. We all have our own story and we are all going through something, you know, but you have to find it in yourself to kind of, you know, find the faith, find the force in to just move forward. You know, today is always a new day, no matter what it is that you're going through. You are okay. If you find that in the community, if you find that in your sorority, your sisters, you know, your friends, your mom, whomever it is, even just you as an individual, if you just find that and you force yourself to move forward, to move past it, to forward progress, you will be undeniably brilliant and a queen, and you will find your passion and you could spark something in someone else. You know, I always say some people aren't, you know, ready for the word, but that shouldn't stop you from dropping a few moments of knowledge or, you know, encouraging somebody else.
Fight the Force, when I hear that, I don't feel like it's negative. I think it's just basically changing the narrative.
Way to Homegrown Radio.
This is gonna be fun, you know? It's gonna be an interview talking about Fight the Force. It's gonna be interesting to see the responses that I get at this interview. When I came up with the idea to put Fight the Force together, it started off as a photo shoot. I was gonna do a girl in the middle of LA wearing an all-white outfit, wearing a crown, and, you know, pose and just show those visuals. And the hashtag was, who you calling a bitch? It was going to be fun. But, you know, it wasn't enough. So fast forward to February of 2018, you know, fast forward a few months later, we had a photo shoot. Had about 7-8 girls, different ethnicities, different ages, you know, wearing all royal colors, you know, navy blue, burgundy, purple, emerald green, or rose gold. You know, just to see women represent themselves, you know, in another light.
Right.
And to wear that crown very, very proudly, you know, and to just say the challenge itself was a statement, you know, it was a powerful statement for women everywhere. And then not just for women, but for men as well.
Oh, you got that one?
It could be something when the girls told you somebody called them.
Yeah, literally anything that you've been called, anything that you've heard, anything that your friends have been called, whatever, you can write it on the board.
You know, the funny thing is, man.
Or Butterface?
Man.
Oh, yeah. Oh, who you calling Butterface? Man. This is supposed to be my best friend over here.
I admit this.
Like, how you gonna have a best friend putting something together like this and you literally calling people that? Like,
first off, you know, I love women folk.
You are a grade A asshole.
I love women, I respect women folk. I mean, like, without them, we are nothing. Y'all make everything we do is for women folk. Everything we do is for women folk. But everything.
Some
of them.
Is this yours?
Yeah.
So, I love women folk, but I'm honest as fuck, though. I'm a booty man, and a girl with no booty is super ugly. It's like, hey. Damn. Hey. Damn. Hey.
So, what made you come up with that?
I've been around women my entire life. You know, my mom is a single mother. I have plenty of friends, my sister, I have cousins, I have plenty of aunties. And the one thing I've always known is that they've always told me and I've always seen how hard they all worked. The thing was, I never saw them actually like enjoy the fruits of their labors too often. So I wanted to kind of create something, you know, that helped, you know, recognize that, you know, that hard work. Because a lot of women do a lot of work, you know, my mom just included. Like, my mom is the biggest influence for this thing. Also, my grandmother as well. So, you know.
Shout out to your mom.
Yeah.
all the women. Yes. Seriously, it's hard. It's real hard out here. Single parents, right?
Yeah, you guys are doing the thing.
And we're careers. They got school, mm-hmm. everything, you know, and you still gotta get up and go to work and you still gotta do what you gotta do and still try to live your dream.
Exactly.
Right? At the same time.
Exactly. Right? You know?
I just really started celebrating. I'm gonna be honest.
You got to. I mean, that's what women do. They fight the force on the daily. Like, the force is everything that's meant to hold a woman down. That's exactly what the force is. And I know plenty of women who fight the force every single day. That's a daily thing. They get up fighting the force. Yep. You know, they go to sleep fighting the force. They get up the next day fighting the force. This is something that, you know, needs to be talked about. That's definitely true.
Very true. Fight the force.
Yes.
I think the state of women today is power. It's very powerful. I feel like our voice is not only finally being heard, but taken seriously. And now the voice is understood. Because there's a difference if, I hear you. But it's being empathized with. And I think we're being taken seriously. And more so because of, you know, it's unfortunate that we have to create these hashtags and these marches of the Me Toos, you know, fuck you, pay me now. Those type of things. It's unfortunate that, you know, we have to go to those extremes to create that for our voice to go beyond being heard and then being taken seriously. So,
you know, I think the state of women today is increasingly becoming more aware of their value, and we are increasingly becoming more, you know, just aware of our surroundings and our power, really. You know, I think with so many different women movements going on, I think that not only the past generation, but the current generation is starting to realize what kind of voice we have. You know, the power of our voice. And when we come and band together as one, instead of trying to stand, you know, separately, and we actually unite, I think that women are starting to realize that we hold a lot of power, a lot of power, and I think that we're starting to use that for the best, to the best of our ability.
I think women have certainly progressed. There's definitely room for more progression. I see the biggest things in areas where, career-wise, where men have predominantly dominated those fields, like, for example, sports. Michelle Beadle, I remember her 10 years ago when I worked at CSTV in New York. She was behind the desk, and I loved that about her because at that time, you really only saw the beautiful size zero on the sideline woman doing sports, and they didn't know anything about sports. And now you see a lot of women coming to the forefront and sitting at that broadcaster's table. So I see progression there. I see progression in my industry, stand-up comedy. You know, Mitzi Shore created the Comedy Store, and we had the Belly Room, which was for women. You know, we have the movement of female comedians really coming out and saying exactly what's on our mind, owning our bodies. Ali Wong doing her two specials, pregnant with her underwear show and giving no qualms about it. She just went out and did it, and I love that. You see Amy Schumer coming out and owning her sexuality and not being afraid to step outside the box. We see people like Melissa McCartney owning being a big woman, or a bigger woman, I should say. She's not even a big woman, but owning who she is and not having to be this stereotypical, beautiful Barbie-type woman. So in terms of that, I definitely see progression. I think we have a long way to go. I think there's still a lot of glass ceilings. There's still a lot of perceptions that women are coming up against. I think we've come a long way, but I think we got more work to do.
So this here is the Fight the Force negative reality board, and it's who you call in, and basically all these words that are on here are what women are called on a daily basis. It's just really unfortunate that, you know, there's so many more words that aren't on this board that women get called. And knowing as a woman and like what we stand for and what we go through and how we give life, you know, that people really have the audacity to call women these names. And as a woman, to have been called some of these names, to know what it feels like to be affected by these words. And it's definitely time to fight the force.
I feel like there are struggles for women these days in regards to just fitting in, not even fitting in, but making sure our expectations are the same expectations that men have, or that are held for men. And in the industry, I feel like we have to kind of work harder, just like it is for people of color. I feel like we have to work 10 times harder just to be on the same level as, you know, someone who might not be of color, just because that's the way society's set up. So I feel like as a woman, we have to kind of work harder so that we can, I mean, it shouldn't be like that, but I feel like that's what it is. And that's just, you know, my opinion.
I have come across a couple of obstacles, and they're unspoken obstacles. I feel like people don't take me as seriously, or when I present myself in meetings, they're either shocked that I'm carrying myself the way that I am. I just noticed that in a lot of circles, there are many boys clubs where I feel like people with maybe less knowledge, less talent, are just accepted into these circles because they're like, oh no, you're my boy, so you got, you know, like there's so many different connections within the boys club. And I feel like as a woman, I don't wanna be a part of the boys club, but I'm like, can we just create a rhythm amongst all professionals within this industry so that things can get done? You know what I mean? Like, I think that's the most prominent thing that I can realize. It's just, you know, the boys club. It's very cliquish, and within each circle, they get whatever it is that they need to get done for their artists. I don't see as many of those circles on the women's side, you know?
That's gonna be an and. Oh, right here.
Right here. Yeah. Right. She does the booty.
Yep, that's gonna be an and.
Hi, I'm Hydia Muhammad, and I am a professional ballroom and Latin dance instructor, and I'm also the founder of The Blind Dance Company. The Blind Dance Company is a startup nonprofit organization, and it's dedicated to empowering the lives of the visually impaired. I started The Blind Dance Company a little bit over a year ago, basically with the goal to just give people who are very often looked over a chance to do different things in society that a lot of people think that they're not capable of doing. When you're teaching someone with a disability, everybody learns differently, whether you can see or not, whether you can hear or not, whether you can walk or not, everybody has their different way of learning. So it's the same thing with my dancers who are blind. They don't all learn the same. Some of them can touch and feel me to figure out the movements. Some of them have to hear me say it a few times and they can get it on their own. But for the most part, I do what I do because I love the process. I love watching growth. I love experiencing growth. And what makes me sleep well at night about this organization is the fact that they genuinely enjoy the steps. They enjoy performing. Some of my dancers have never danced before this, and they do a phenomenal job at getting up there and putting on a great show as if they've been doing it their whole lives. And some of them danced before they went blind, and when they went blind, they never thought they could do this before. They never thought this opportunity would be available to them again. And now they're able to dance, they're able to act and perform. We have shows and fundraisers where they can do some of their other talents, such as rap and sing. So they're being able to experience their passions in life again through this opportunity of the Blind Dance Company.
So y'all gonna have to change your weight because y'all need the right leg. So when you spin it in, so left, right, left, close your feet, Barbara.
The beauty in teaching as an instructor and starting at such a young age was the fact that I am a woman and I'm African American. So in the ballroom world, there's literally a handful of African American instructors, especially professional dancers in that industry. So that was something that was always so different for me. With teaching the Blind Dance Company, it's the same. I feel that a lot of times in this industry, women aren't valued enough in the dance industry. And growing up as a dancer, that was something that was always, you know, shown to me. I never felt really like I was gonna be the most important standing next to a man because, especially in the ballroom world, there's not as many male dancers as there is female professional dancers. And I want the women to feel just as important as dancers as the guys feel. And I want to be able to always have that respect amongst society as a young African-American female professional dancer who's now, you know, starting an organization in an area full of people that's, you know, dominated by males. And to gain that respect and to gain that acknowledgement, I know it's something that takes time, but it starts with us putting that best foot forward and making that effort more and more each day to show ourselves, to show our worth, to show our talents, to show our truth, to show what we're capable of. And I know as a woman, as a young African-American professional dancer, I know that I have that power to show that to the world. And I know that we all have that power to show that. And it starts by just doing what we do best.
How did I personally feel when I heard Queen Latifah's UNITY? I was young. I was really young. I was like 7 or 8. But that doesn't take away from the, you know, the idea of like my brothers and my sisters, you know what I mean, knocking it, rocking it in the car. You know, it was like windows down. I'm from Oakland. Y'all saw that. You know, so it definitely didn't take away from me actually having heard it. I don't think it necessarily resonated with me at such a young age. But if I go back and listen to it today, you know, I think Queen Latifah's words are, she was a pioneer. She definitely spearheaded a movement. I think, you know, this, it sparked something. I think at that time, because there were so many other women and strong women speaking out, you know, in the 90s, doing major things, whether it was in television or, you know, the industry in and of itself. You know, the first woman astronaut, you know, things like that that, you know, allowed women to kind of let young girls like myself at the time know, like, you have endless possibilities, you know, so you just don't belittle yourself. Don't allow yourself to be kind of, you know, taken and put into this box just based off of what other men or other people will say about you.
My generation, we were seekers. We were pronounced because of Queen Latifah. Who you calling a bitch? You know, we were pronouncing that way. Lauryn Hill, you know, I'm a champion. You know what I mean? So it's just, now you hear things in social media, in music, in magazines, where women think it's okay that you could be referenced as a bitch. Don't ever respond to that. Even when your girl calls you that, we should never respond to that. You know, my generation was, again, who you calling? This, my name is so-and-so. It was a different demand. The demand for respect is completely different, because the respect right now, the demand of respect right now is, oh, you gonna give me some shoes, you gonna give me a handbag. You know, so it's just, I'm sorry, young women, but we gotta get it together.
The production and the melodies and just the way that it makes you feel even today, it's a classic. And I loved seeing strong black woman representing and standing up for other women. I remember looking at it as a little girl and just feeling proud, like, wow, that's us. You know what I mean? Like, or that could be us. And that's right. Like, you can't call us a bitch. You can't call us, you know? Like, it hurt Queen Latifah taking a stand for women. It was almost like she became our spokesperson for other young generation and women, and we kind of felt like, oh no, we can stand up for ourselves now. Like, you can't do that. So I think it was a pivotal point for the music industry and for women all together, and it still lives on today.
Days at work give you an attitude and you were broke. And take it out on me, but that's about enough. You put your hands on me again, I'll put your ass in handcuffs.
You know, there's gonna probably be some women that may denounce this, what I'm gonna say. I think there's been drastic changes. And I can only speak for my generation and speak for where I am as a woman in the workplace and personally. I think there's been drastic changes because Queen Latifah spoke up for all of us to say, who you calling a bitch, and I punched him dead in his eye, but I'm cool. I'll get on the motorcycle and ride with you. I'll even get in the rap game with you. So that leads us into music and rapping. And music, if you was an artist and you was a woman, it's because you were gospel or you were R&B. My generation kicked open the door to say, I can be beyond that. I can also rap. And also too, I can feel confident in my body that I can come out and be exactly who I am, you know? So from that, what that did is it instigated being a boss of who you are, then internalize that to be like, oh, well, wait a minute, beyond being the boss of my body, I can also be a boss in the workplace. I can be a boss and control, you know, what I'm doing.
You know, since then we've had, you know, the Women's Against Violence Act passed, which was passed in 94. They readjusted it in 2005 to include children, you know, child victims. In 2007, I think Nancy Pelosi was the first, you know, woman House representative. You know, our wages have gone up quite, you know, a little bit. They haven't, obviously, you know, we're not fair wages yet with men, but they've gone up quite a bit. You know, our ability to work in different fields, you know, whether it's engineering or NASA or, you know, kind of, you know, mechanics. those kind of things have really given women an opportunity to, you know, to rise and to become, you know, to actually just be looked at as equals. And songs like You and ITY, I think, have really, you know, they push for this, like, just if you respect yourself, people have no choice but to respect you. You know, if you allow people to call you a hoe, or if you answer to bitch, you know, then people are gonna be like, oh, well, then she obviously doesn't have a problem with that. You know, so I think songs like that, that encourage women to just, you know, take a look at yourself. And, you know, you guys, if you exude what other people allow you to be, then that's what you're gonna be. You know, so if you kind of, if you stop, if you hear someone call you a bitch or a hoe or a slut or whatever else, you know, they've been called, then, and you don't necessarily, like, you know, say anything or stand up for yourself, or, you know what I mean, kind of reject that sort of attention, then you're gonna be taking in that kind of energy for forever.
Hi, my name is Liz Marie, and I am a creative director, strategist, mentor, and founder of Morning Sunshine, which is a community event series designed to empower people to grow and reach their full potential.
So this is the part where we're going to work together. I'm going to put you into groups of three. You're not going to be with people you know on purpose. And what you're going to do is each of you are going to have about 10 minutes to share your answers. And while that person is sharing, I need the other two people to be really engaged, active listeners, focused on understanding what they're telling you, trying to understand them as a person, giving that person your full attention. And at the end, you're going to kind of recap the things that you heard. So as you're listening, try to identify common themes that seem to come up in their answers. You know, they might talk about their kids or their family a lot. They might talk about this specific passion. So you're going to reflect back to them at the end for just a couple of minutes and try to help them identify some of those themes.
I started Morning Sunshine to try to spread some positivity into people's lives. And for me, I knew it was something that I was fully capable of. And as that relates to being a woman, it's not something I ever questioned in my mind. I know that we face unique challenges as women, but it has never really been internalized for me that I need to second guess anything that I'm doing or worry about the social constraints that are put on me. I just try to go out and fucking do it. So I set my mind to putting on these events, to connecting with people for my own personal growth. And it's not really something I've put a lot of thought into, how that might be perceived for me as a woman, or how that might hold me back. I try not to put a lot of thought to it, but I've realized over time that there aren't as many women in my position that have that mindset or that are empowered to do that. And that's something I'm really passionate about proliferating and spreading around to younger generations or even just people around me, the sense that you don't have to be stopped or held back just because there are these perceptions or limitations. It's really about what you want and what you go after.
Every, I think walk over. So as soon as they're done walking over, we can start.
Just people in general did a lot to make this happen for you. As you can see, you all have a bag, a Lakers bag at that, that you came in with, and they have some other stuff that they're going to acknowledge and give away. So I just ask that you just give your undivided attention to them and be respectful because they're taking the time out of their day to give back to you all. So I am going to introduce the moderator for this event, and that is Ms. Natalia Jackson. So if you can please give her a round of applause.
Okay, do I have any basketball fans? Basketball fans? LeBron James? Yes. Okay, well, a lot of you, when I ask about basketball, probably majority of this room is going to talk about a male basketball player. So I'm going to just come from the angle of sports. I think over the course of time, women have been more recognized for their athletic ability, but it's still not to a pace that it'll be even, or if it's ever going to be even. But I think that as women, we have to strive to be the best that we can. That's all we can do, and we can't be denied by the people's doubts or people's thought process, or, oh, you're just a girl, or you play like a girl. You get out there with one of those women hoopers, one of those WNBA players, one of those girls, any one of those girls would ball anybody in this room up right now. You know, and it's true. It's true. I can, whoever's in there talking right now, I can leave these heels on, I bet I'll bust you up.
It's important to value women who do so much, and I'm thankful that these women are here today to talk to you guys.
You know, regardless of what society says we're supposed to look like, or supposed to dress like, or supposed to act like, it's like, look, I am who I am, and I'm gonna be that 24/7, all day long, 100%. So, you know, the older I get, the more comfortable I get in that skin, and the more confident I get. And just advice to young women out there, men love confidence. No matter what you look like, or, you know, none of those things really matter, the superficial things, when you get older and you're really looking for someone to, you know, build a life with. The only thing that you need is to believe in yourself and have self-confidence and walk in that stride.
There's a very bright producer, woman producer in music, but I guarantee she's not the first person that comes to your mind. I know Missy Elliott, but if you think about producing, you probably think of Timbaland versus Missy Elliott. Basketball, just like Don mentioned earlier. Everybody watches the NBA. Have any of you guys watched a WNBA game before? All right, I like that. See, we're progressing a little bit, but that was probably like 10% of the room. Has anybody watched an NBA game before? I know you all have. So, like I said, the struggle has been real, but it's getting better. And I believe that it will get better. And that's, I think, what we're all here to do, is to change that perspective and to change the fact that there's such a low count of women doing any kind of job in general.
Oh man, the next generation of young girls, this is what I do it for, let me tell you. This is what I do it for. The youth is, I'm super, super passionate about the youth, especially women. I really, in my heart, I hold a deep, deep place for women that, young women that have been through a variety of things, whether it's physical abuse, just everything. So I definitely feel like I want to inspire women to kind of not fear the unknown and just focus on their dreams. And I feel like a lot of women growing up, young women growing up, were taught, you know, were to play with Barbies, or that, you know, that whole fairy tale love story, or just to focus on love so much. And I feel like that's cool. And that's how I am. I'm a super hard lover, but I feel like we need to teach our young women more than just these, you know, Disney Cinderella love stories. We need to teach them about how they can be independent on their own, or to follow their dreams, or just like other things than just love, because I feel like we grow up thinking that that's all life's about, or we grow up thinking, and I mean, we are emotional humans, us women, but I feel like we need to be taught kind of other things growing up as well, so that we can, you know, be okay being on our own, not needing someone to be with, or you know what I mean? So.
If anything, the younger generation coming up now, because they're seeing everybody opening up their voices, I feel like there's no fear for them, especially. They want to be heard. They have very distinct ideas about how they would like to see things moving forward. So I applaud the youth for moving forward with a certain kind of freedom, you know, to just break the norms.
To be very transparent, I'm very nervous. I'm very nervous and I'm very concerned. And I know this is gonna sound like a contradiction to what I said earlier about working at Vibe and women getting into the space of rap music and being confident and owning who they were in terms of their bodies. Because you think about Lil' Kim when she first came out on the scene, it was such a shock to us at that age. Like, is this porn? You know, but watching the reaction of the other men, like, oh shit. You know, and then knowing who Lil' Kim was. So that's a big difference too, because that was her way of saying, I know exactly who I am and I'm gonna be feminine and I'm a woman, but this is my boss light, this is my ego. So she knew how to play the duality of two different characters. I'm not sure if women today know how to do that. I think women are led by social media, and social media is dictating you have to look like this, which is a blow up doll. You have to look like this, which is the same measurements, you know, of a next girl. I think the generation of women today, I don't think they're readers. I think they're numb. I think they're void of knowing how to build companionship. I think they're less concerned about building a career versus just having jobs.
Being quiet and staying silent is what kept us down for so many years. You know, my mother, uneducated, scared to death to leave my father, even though it's probably the best thing for her. And it's because of how she was raised. Now me, I don't care. I say what I think. That is what it is, right? So I just encourage young women to speak your mind, use your intelligence before you use your body. Your body is there. Your body is gonna work for you all the time. You don't have to lead with it. Your body is beautiful. Don't be ashamed of it. Own it. But your mind is more powerful, and now you're in a position to be able to use it. Whereas 25 years ago, 30 years ago, no, you weren't. You had to be coming up under a man. You had to be reliant on a man. We're not in that day and age anymore, ladies. Let's go.
What I do think is missing is the connection between the older generation and the younger generation. I wish there were more conversations. It's also important to just know a little bit more history to understand why it's so important to use this current time with integrity, because it's taken a long time to even get here.
You look at the women that orchestrated Black Lives Matter. We on the grounds, we always been on the front line, we on the grounds. They're there to remind us, hey, 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 we still here, we on the grounds. Hey, 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 we still thinkers, we're still leaders. So it gives me hope in the way that those women that feel like, oh, I'm numb, or oh, I'm a bad bitch, or I'm popcorn, I'm blow up, that when that bag does deflate, they could fall back on those other women that's been on the front line. So it's an odd place for me, because I'm sure this was said about my generation.
Sometimes I'm probably not the bad ones, but we all kind of judge others.
Yeah, right. So as a woman who runs the Drew League and has all these powerful women, you know, on your league, who possibly go through all these things you're about to see, how does it feel to know
that this is something that women experience on a daily basis. And even ourselves.
Wow. It don't feel good. And the thing is, the one I don't like the most, I see frequently on this board. And it just really goes against everything that we're about here. Here at the Women's Drew League, my biggest thing is gaining respect for women's basketball and respect, period. And looking at this board, there's a lot of disrespect. So definitely I feel some type of way about it. I don't like what I see. And hopefully sometime in the future, you know, we can change these.
And fight the force.
Fight the force, yes.
There's a lot of words on here, man.
It's crazy to think that this is a daily basis kind of thing for women.
Right here, stuck up. I've never been that. I don't get why people would ever like label me that.
Yeah.
Like, how could I be labeled something ever?
Yeah. They don't give you a chance to even get to know you before they even got to say something.
Like, how can you call me stuck up and you haven't even approached me?
Yeah.
You've never approached me. So that one really stands out the most too.
If I had any advice for the next generation, it would be to slow down. Everyone is in such a hurry to grow up. Everyone is in such a hurry to be, you know, this older version of themselves. You know, and I get it. When I was younger, I know I said, I can't wait to sit at the, you know, grown-up table. I can't wait to get into the clubs. I can't wait to, you know, do this on my own and move out. So I understand it. And of course, that it's kind of what the surface looks like. But deep down, like, there are so many responsibilities. And you will always be older and getting older. So there's just no hurry.
Figure out what it is you want to do, what you feel like your purpose is. A few people have told me that, you know, it's a process, so not to rush, you know, not to pressure yourself on what is my purpose, what am I supposed to do? Just try different things, see what works, see what you love, what you enjoy. Don't do something just because of the money. Do it because you enjoy it and then you love it and the passion and the money will come.
Stand for something. The advice that I have for young women is find something that you love and you passionate about and stand for it, root for it. Find you first. Because you could, before you could stand for anything, you got to find you first. And you in there, you know, don't let someone else dictate who you are.
Continue to be fearless. Continue to move with integrity, though, because I don't want this younger generation to be looked upon, females specifically, by the males. Like, oh, they're only doing this because, you know, they've been protesting and we have to do this. Like, I want us to be respected and looked at like, you know what? She really knows what she's talking about. She really has some great ideas. I respect that, you know? And taking away some of the sexuality that's attached to it, because I think that that's kind of sometimes where the lines get blurred are, because I feel like that's also heightened nowadays, and women feeling the freedom to express themselves through their sexuality, it can sometimes blur the lines, because then I think it becomes a distraction.
I would say, put your phone down. You know, go to a concert without recording it on your phone or watching it through your phone. You know, go to lunch without, you know, just having to be on your phone all the time. Just be in the moment for a second, you know, just kind of slow down, take a moment, because after a while, that moment's gone. You know, and you're gonna look up and you are 60 and you are 70 and you are 30 and you are 40 with kids and responsibilities and, you know, you have to take care of other people, and those things never go away. Once you're there, it never goes away.
We all, you know, fear stuff sometimes. I do still, but when it comes to my dreams or my aspirations or what I feel I want to do, I just go for it, because by you sitting back and thinking, oh, what if I do this, or what if it doesn't work out, or what if I lose, then you're just wasting your time and wasting the one life that you're living. So I feel like live life with no fear, and remember that fear is an illusion and you can do anything you put your mind to.
7.
I'm Natalia.
I'm Nancy.
We're here to fight the force.
And I'm here to fight the force. Are you?
Are you?
What's up, y'all? I'm Amber Brashear. I'm a stand-up comedian based in L.A., originally from North Carolina. Got to L.A. by way of NYC.
Name is Erica Connor. I am a producer of all content, film, television, art, music. And I am currently VP of development at One Media Productions.
Hey everyone, I'm Gloria Govan. I'm a TV personality. I'm originally from Oakland, California, but I'm out here in Los Angeles currently.
My name is Leslie Nicole Lewis. I am originally from Brooklyn, New York, but I now reside in Los Angeles. I used to be an artist. I used to be a part of a girl group called Electric Red, and now I'm doing artist management.
What's up, y'all? It's Christina Cooper. I am an actress turned producer turned director, and we are here in Los Angeles, and yeah, welcome to Fight the Force.